This afternoon, we hear from Martin Edmond, who has penned a double biography on celebrated Aranda artist Albert Namatjira and white Australian watercolourist Rex Battarbee. We'll also hear from Erik Jensen, whose account of former enfant terrible of Australian art, Adam Cullen, is utterly compelling. The title or the framework for this session, for the next hour, is The Lives of Artists. And the moment I read that, I didn't craft it, but the moment I read it, I was reminded of what is often referred to as the first art history. That is, The Lives of Artists, written by Giorgio Vasari in 1550. Now, Vasari's account of his artists who were predominantly close friends, the artists of his time and place, is extraordinarily partisan. It's a privileged and a particular perspective that he shares. So I'm interested to see how this session will uncover, unravel perhaps, this very idea, the obvious abiding fascination of with the lives of artists rather, and our continued obsession with the artist. Now I'm just going to introduce briefly our two authors. Born in New Zealand, Martin Edmond has lived in Sydney since 1981. His publications include Luca Antara, Zone of the Marvellous, Dark Night, Walking with McCann, and now, of course, Battarbee and Namatjira. Before us is an Antipodean who has pursued many creative forms, from filmmaking to taxi driving, theatre, and of course writing, in an attempt, I think, to work out who and what we are. Can I ask you to join me in welcoming Martin Edmond? And directly on my right, we have Wunderkind, and he's going to hate that. But we have Wunderkind Erik Jensen. Now, Erik is the founding editor of the Saturday paper, which I believe celebrates its first birthday today.
It does.
Yay. Fabulous. Erik was about 25 when he left the Sydney Morning Herald to work on the Saturday paper. At that point, he already had 10 years in the game under his belt. He's written for numerous publications and he's, I think, tender. It's not a word that's been used yet to describe your biography, but the tender biography of Adam Cullen, titled Acute Misfortune, is his first book. The other magical thing about this man is that he knows shorthand. Please join me in welcoming Erik Jensen. We're going to kick things off with a reading from both of our writers. And I'll ask Martin to begin, if that's okay.
Certainly. Thank you. This is a short piece from the end of chapter 3 of this book. The context is a trip to Alice Springs that Rex Battarbee took with his travelling partner and painting friend John Gardner. 1934, I believe it is. Battarbee and Gardner went by way of Copperillia Springs and Jay Creek, the 80 miles back to Alice Springs, where they camped on the outskirts of town for a few weeks, waiting for some mail that had gone astray. There was a rush on to the Granites to the north, where gold had been discovered. They caught up with the cricket on the radio. The Bodyline series was gearing up to begin. So it must have been 1932. Rex shopped in town or at the market gardeners. I got a wonderful parsnip. Yarned with the locals, swapped books with other readers, developed photographs in the evenings. He was reading crime writer Edgar Wallace, author of King Kong. And after a visit to Emily's Gap in the East to view the totemic art stenciled on the rock there, remarked, "There is a lot about this gap in Sir Baldwin Spencer's book." He struck up an acquaintance with an Afghan camel driver, a devout Muslim, who told him biblical stories from the Islamic point of view. The story of Joseph was very good, also Noah. He made them more real than I have ever heard before. He and Jack acquired some dingo scalps, but couldn't sell them at the store. Later they exchanged them for Abo stones and other artifacts, including a shield. But Rex didn't really like being in town, even as small a town as Alice was then. I don't feel at home here. Towns are no good to camp at, and the people seem different. So they packed up and went back onto the land to find places where they could stay in the wild and, weather permitting, do their painting. On the 24th of November, a Thursday, Rex wrote, "This has been a beautiful day. I worked on three sketches, finishing two. Jack shot another turkey this afternoon, a hen. While we were having tea, a couple of blacks came along on camels. They came over. They were from Hermansburg. One was the camel man who comes into Alice Springs." He continues the next day, "While I was sketching, the camel man from Hermansburg came up and stayed a while. He became very interested in the painting. He is a very nice chap. This meeting, late in 1932, at Temple Bar Creek near Simpson's Gap, between the 37-year-old itinerant watercolour painter from Baker's Road, Blackburn, Victoria, and the camel man from Hermansburg, like the earlier encounters on the banks of the Fink, was not certainly one between Rex Battarbee and Albert Namatjira. Albert is at this stage still indistinct, anonymous, a man generally described by means of his occupation, not his name. Nevertheless, those meetings can stand as a beginning of the story of their collaboration, which would prove lifelong for both men. And like many events that, in retrospect, are highly significant, they must at the time have seemed commonplace, a casual encounter like hundreds of others that happen every day among people on the road."
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to throw to a question now, because it fits in so beautifully with that chosen section. Next year marks the 80th anniversary of 1936, of course, of the first kind of camping trip, the first painting trip. Both men were, importantly, already established artists, and I think you give us a wonderful account of that, particularly, both of them, actually.
Yes.
Equally. Battarbee finding his form as a form of convalescence post-war.
Yeah.
And, of course, and this is very well illustrated in our collections in Adelaide, particularly the Flinders University Art Museum, and Namatjira is predominantly a carver of Punu, and also, I guess, an illustrator.
And a poker work artist.
Yeah.
Burning designs into wood, yeah.
Absolutely. Mm. An art form that has probably spent, has been eclipsed or lost or forgotten, but I think will be soon to return. You have just read from a section which positions a possible beginning for an extraordinary art historical encounter in 1932, and the way in which it's positioned as a possibility gives great insight into the way you've worked. What is this thing? You talk about the kind of indistinct, so there's not a kind of self-assured kind of position in which you cite this beginning with the kind of rigour that art historians are well known for. I enjoy your relaxation of that, by the way, just as an aside. Mm-hmm. But I'd love you just to, you know, we know that this started as a kind of doctoral form or a doctoral pathway. What is this thing? What propelled you, and what do we call this thing?
I started with a question, and the question was really a very simple question. I'd written a book about Ludwig Becker, yeah, who was with Burke and Wills to his ultimate cost, and there's a painting of Becker's that looks like a Namatjira.
Yeah.
But it looked to me like a Namatjira, both in terms of the composition, but more importantly in terms of the colour. And I looked at it and I thought, I wonder if there's any connection between Becker and Namatjira. Mm-hmm. And that's an art historical question, but it's also just a purely historical question. I was trying to satisfy my own curiosity, really. And I knew that there was this fellow called Rex Battarbee who had something to do with Namatjira, and I knew that he came out of Melbourne. So I thought, okay, I'll go and find a biography of Rex Battarbee, and that'll answer the question. Well, of course, there wasn't a biography of Battarbee, and it really came from that. So it was a quest of a kind, and I got to say, I never answered the question. I don't know.
Yeah. Thank you. So we might hear now from Eric, a passage from Acute Misfortune.
I'll read a passage from the first time that I met Adam, which sort of poses a question, and it became the question that drove the next 4 years that I spent on and off living in his spare room in what became an increasingly claustrophobic and peculiar relationship. But this is its innocent beginning.
All those mattresses without sheets, I still feel unwell.
Yeah. But this is a wholesome start to the book. The first time I met Adam, he told me he was going to die. That was 4 years ago. He was 42. "I know I will be dead because I'm so busy dying," he said. We were standing in his bedroom beside a sheetless mattress. Down from a burst pillow floated just above the floor. From the door you could make out a stack of dishes ossifying in the sink. Death was mentioned without drama, nor was it said in sadness. He was answering, unprompted, the questions of his own racing logic. "I would never kill myself," he said, although the question was never asked. "I'm not fucking gutless. I get depressed, but I'm not fucking gutless." The bed had a wet smell, like rain had got into a dusty room. It was piled with curios, animal skins, and merchandise from shooting clubs. A Templar helmet sat where the pillows should have been, memento of a trip to Spain. "Everything moves towards its end," Adam said. "As soon as you're born, you're busy dying, and I am dying. I suppose I've just been smashing my head against the wall of existence for just a little bit too long." We spent a few hours that day in Adam's glass-fronted studio overhanging the Gross Valley on the edge of Wentworth Falls. He paid a landlady in paintings for the smallish room that looked out at dark bushland and the glinting suburbs of the city's approaches. For me, the studio came to symbolize his mind. On one wall was the private in Adam's life, a missive he claimed a girlfriend had written when he came out of hospital, sketched in what was unmistakably his hand. "I can do this," it read. "I have no fear. I am a great painter." On the other wall, the part of him society saw, an assured signature painted in block letters on an otherwise blank canvas. These were the two parts of his anxiety, the tension that had become his life, above which a pink swastika was sprayed on the ceiling. The room was almost always empty, nervous with spilt paint, stacked occasionally with canvases. And when he stood there, which he did almost every night, there was nowhere to hide from the world as it rushed in through the glass. To prove on this first meeting the conviction he had in his own death, Adam unbuttoned his shirt to show me a scar that twisted the length of his torso. His stomach looked like an oversized carpet bag, stitched poorly at the fastenings. He forced his thumbs into drain holes on either side of his abdomen, ports from the operation that a year earlier had removed his gallbladder and much of his pancreas, and which had healed as enormous pockmarks burred by infection. I asked him what had happened, to fill the silence more than anything. "Acute misfortune," he said. "I think the art world caused this."
Thank you. Thank you. That encounter reads like a contemporary vanitas, really, like a memento mori. So I'd like to kind of, with both authors, discuss the kernel, really, which is why artists? What is it about the artist? Now, for Martin, the artist has been a recurring figure throughout your practice as a writer. And I'm interested to hear Martin's reflections on that, but also Eric, for whom I guess the figure of the artist is a more recent acquaintance.
Well, I started out as a writer contributing to a student newspaper in Wellington, New Zealand, and I started reviewing art shows because I'd knew a painter. I'd lived with a painter the year before in a sort of country house that we squatted in, and I'd watched him painting, and I wanted to write, and I thought, oh, well, I can write about painting. But artists like writers, and I think this partly explains Adam and Eric. And I was very quickly adopted by an artist slightly older than me, a fellow called Philip Claremont, and I became like his artist, his writer. Yep. He wasn't my artist. That was definitely not the way it worked. But when Phil wanted to put on a show, he'd call me up and I'd go around and review it. So from the very beginning of my writing life, I was involved with painters. And I think it's a very interesting sort of relationship, because painting isn't generally about words, and yet increasingly, especially in the last, say, 10 or 15 years, there's very little art that goes out into the world now that isn't accompanied by a vast amount of language.
Unnecessary words.
Usually unnecessary, yes. Absolutely. Yeah. So I became an art writer, and then I became very sick of the language of art writing, but I became very interested in the technique of biography and just the sort of fascination of trying to unravel what these people were doing, and beyond that, what sort of lives they were living. So
Thank you.
For me, I think it's slightly different. I suppose I think of journalism as a trench war, kind of fought against liars. And artists in that respect make the perfect enemy, because so much of the life of an artist is lived on the tenuous fringe of reality. You know, an important thing in great art sometimes is being able to access something just this side of truth, or just that side of truth, depending on where you're standing. Adam was certainly on the other side. But it struck me, and certainly with this book, it happened somewhat by accident, but Adam occurred in my life as this figure who was so large and so unbelievable that I wanted to try and take off some of the masks he was so obviously wearing. And you know, I had a naive 19-year-old vision of the truth being some kind of absolute and real thing. And I was keen to understand what the truth of this particular man was, because I was so disbelieving of what it was he presented, even though, you know, the untruths eventually killed him. They were real enough to do that. But they asked, I suppose, interesting questions of a person whose art ultimately became less and less important to the book.
You both take very different approaches to bringing the work and the artist to life. And Eric was earlier quite kind of dismissive of his attempt in the green room, but I think he does a really extraordinary job of bringing to life the kind of practice, the way of working of Cullen, the way in which the very kind of carpe diem of Cullen's philosophy is, of course, absolutely captured in the way he flirted with paint and with biro and with aerosol and whatever he could kind of get his hands on. And you get that kind of fast and dirty idea that runs through the book in so many ways. Do you want to talk about how you found that, not coming, as you say, coming from journalism? What was the pressure? I mean, it's not ekphrasis per se. It's not that idea of bringing a painting to life through words, but you clearly have a knack for that, and you could clearly get to the visceral aspect of his practice.
I think an early decision made in writing this book, or in researching this book — I didn't write the book until after Adam had died — but in researching it, Adam had said something to me about what he painted or why he painted. He said he painted human car crashes, and while everyone else wanted to see them, no one got up close, but he went right up close and he didn't blink. He refused to recoil. And I decided, you know, it was clear even early on that it would be much too easy to make moral judgments of Adam. He was a man whose life could be easily condemned, and so I decided that I would write without moral judgments and hopefully write without blinking. And no matter what Adam did to me in the course of these 4 years, I sort of refused to recoil. And that's, I think, why the book breathes maybe some life into his work, is because it operates with a similar ethos. And so I wasn't terribly interested in talking about Adam as a colorist or the sensitivity of visual choices that Adam made and so on. I was interested, though, in writing at the kind of speed he painted at, I suppose.
Beautiful. Thank you. I love that. Write without blinking. Now, the challenge was so significant in this respect for Martin because he chose not well. We'll get to it later on. But there are no reproductions of Namatjira or Battarbee's work in the publication. We will talk about it. But let's first up deal with the issue of how to bring the work to life. And you managed to tell a kind of parallel story about, if you like, the rise of a type of desert naturalism for Battarbee and an anthropomorphic realism, perhaps, for Namatjira. I don't know how you feel about those terms. But do you want to just talk about how the sensitivities or the emphasis around bringing the work to life in the book and the tension perhaps with bringing the men to life?
I take Eric's point about not making moral judgments. When I came to look at what had been written about Albert Namatjira particularly, it was very clear immediately in which decade it had been written.
Yeah.
Because the political correctness changed with the decades, and it, each decade inflected Namatjira's achievement differently. And as for Battarbee, there really wasn't anything to go on at all. So I started out with the idea of writing a documentary account, like trying to say there's a story here that should be told insofar as it's possible without making judgments about what it means and what its political ramifications are, even what its artistic ramifications are. I started with a documentary impulse. It's actually not possible to do that because...
But it's a great thing to tell yourself.
But it's a great thing to tell yourself.
Yeah.
That's right. So I was looking for a dispassionate storytelling account, and insofar as the images are concerned, I knew there was a copyright problem from the very beginning, and I knew it was likely that I would end up not being able to get permission to reproduce Namatjira's work. So I made a point of trying to bring the paintings to life on the page just by using words.
Yeah, you do it beautifully.
It's challenging, but it's really satisfying if you can manage to sort of give a reader an image.
Indeed. And it is the figure of Battarbee that I found the kind of redemption, or maybe the reintroduction of Battarbee in this account, that I find so satisfying. History had kind of turned the other way, art history that is, where Battarbee was designated as a kind of wellspring for Namatjira and then completely abandoned, you could say. And the 36 camping trip has become a kind of false beginning for both men. And so I think you did an absolutely beautiful job, no doubt aided by Gail Quambi. How do we say her surname?
Quambi. Gail Quambi. That's Rex's daughter, yeah.
So her particularly being able to access some of Rex's diaries meant that you could bring Rex and his more than 25-year commitment to Arunda artists to life.
Yeah, I think it's rare. I mean, it's sort of rare to find a genuinely good person in the world, or in the historical world as well. But I think in Rex Battarbee there is a man of virtue. I mean, he was a Christian, but he wasn't a proselytizing Christian. But he does seem to have lived out the ethic of Christianity in a manner that was really quite remarkable, and he didn't he wasn't a self-promoting kind of a person. And I think what happened to Rex is that he realised that there was a greater demand upon him than just pursuing his own art. So as you say, for 25 years he really dedicated himself to the founding of the Hermannsburg School. And I think it's important to realise that without Hermannsburg there would not have been Papunya.
Absolutely.
So without Rex Battarbee you probably would have not seen the desert art movement in the form that we have it, certainly. So.
And it feels that the book rolls on even when it's finished into Papunya, particularly because of course Namatjira ends up there. So
yeah, that's where they put him in jail.
Yeah, it's where he's incarcerated. Mm. Yeah, a place that's now considered as, a, as we said, a kind of, in some ways a false, but absolutely celebrated origin point, I suppose, of Western Desert painting. Mm. It's a nice segue, isn't it, from the, virtuous Rex into Adam Cullen. you mentioned earlier, Eric, that one of the greatest problems that people are having with the book is the fact that you decided to create a book around a demon. So do you want to just talk a little bit about, for me, you know, for a while there I was calling it rather cheekily acute misogyny rather than acute misfortune. Mm. I found parts of it very, very difficult.
Adam's parts, not mine, just to be clear.
Yes, that's right. Indeed. Indeed. Certainly as a curator, I've never met Adam Cullen, but I was working in 2008, 2009 with Ben Quilty on his book and exhibition, and I got to know of Cullen through Ben's accounts. They were quite kind of close, if you could be, at that time. So the redemption for me is his love for you. I see this as absolutely a love story. Oh, sorry, I don't mean to sound cynical. I really don't. Yeah. For me, the way in which Eric is entangled and certainly Adam is so ambivalent about his emotions, of course, reflected in a kind of performed misogyny, is really compelling. Mm. Can you talk about the love story?
Yeah, I mean, biography is a strangely intimate thing. And Adam mistook the intimacy of biography for love. And that only dawned on me very late, really, just before Adam died. But what we're talking about there, I suppose, is not so much love. It's why a person like Adam, a man who, I mean, this book began as a lie. This book began with him pretending to have a book contract to convince yes. me to stay in his house.
Thames and Hudson, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yep. But, you know, Adam's lies papered over the fact that he didn't know who he was. And as a person who was a fantasist, who deliberately misled people about who he was constantly, who created a huge and very complex myth for himself, a myth that became less and less complex the more he performed it, for a person like that to invite into their life a biographer to catch them is a strange thing. And it took me a long time to properly understand what it was he was doing, but I think what he was really doing was trying to arrive at some truth about himself, truth he couldn't even get to because he had suppressed so much of who he was. He'd hidden from his sexuality. He'd invented feuds with everyone from his mother to, you know, to the man down the street to isolate himself. And he was doing all of that because he didn't want really to start to be in any kind of relationship that would cause him to ask who he was. And he died, I think, knowing a little bit more about who he was, but having gone through the rigmarole of getting a biographer to ask him the questions that caused him to understand who he was, and doing that all the while because he wanted to come out to his father in a book that would be published after he died. Mm. You know, the most kind of elaborate and sad way to tell the truth. Mm.
And the difficulty of particularly a posthumous account is introduced to us in the prelude, which I found really amusing because it's with one of Australia's least accessible artists, not successful, least accessible, least knowable, the figure of Dale Frank.
Yeah.
So I love the fact that we're introduced straight up to Frank, who no one really knows, and Frank articulates his ambivalence around... He kind of likes you, but doesn't really want to like you. He's not sure.
Story of my life, Lisa.
Oh, really? There you go. The kind of truth question looms, which is really interesting, given that he's kind of a bit of a cynic.
Yeah, I mean, Dale is a cynic and perhaps even a hermit.
Yep.
But he's also hugely knowing and articulate and became an early mentor of Adam's. Mm. Adam arrived at Dale Frank's door in, I think, 1986. He was an art student, and he wanted, you know, at the time, and still, Frank was an enormous figure in Australian art. He wanted Dale to become his mentor. And he stood there with dyed blue hair, or green hair, and Dale answered the door with dyed green hair. And it was only later that Dale realised that Adam had coloured his hair for the sake of this meeting. It was the beginning of the kind of many lies that Adam would tell. But I began the book that way, partly because I wanted all of those questions articulated by someone other than me, because I think it's very boring for a writer to tell you about their concerns before you get down to business.
Yeah, we wouldn't have liked you so much.
But it's important that you have those concerns. Mm. And also, this book is told entirely in the 4 years I knew Adam. He was, as you heard in that passage, essentially dead the day I met him, and he just kept on dying all through that time. But Dale knew him at a time when he was full of life and ambition and making really interesting work. Mm. And I wanted this kind of strange time capsule produced after his death, but with someone who knew him very well when he was on the make, to be the kind of framing, I suppose, for what then becomes, not so much a linear biography in any way. I think the book explains who Adam was, but, you know, it explains who he was from his deathbed, essentially.
Absolutely. Thank you. Now, I've asked each of the authors to ask a question of the other, because I think that's really can be insightful. They're both familiar with each other's works. Martin's actually reviewed An Acute Misfortune. I don't know why I always put an N in the front of it. I've got to stop doing that. Acute Misfortune. So, do you want to go first, Martin?
Sure.
Question for Eric?
Yeah. The question I want to ask Eric is, what do you think Adam thinks of the job you've done on him in your book?
One of the trickiest things about this book is the fact that it was published after Adam died.
Yes.
On the flip side, I'd more or less given up on the project in the last months of Adam's life. I'd moved cities. He was calling me six times a day. Right. He'd become completely obsessed with me and completely unreasonable in his demands.
Right.
And it was only his death that caused me to look across at the crate of shorthand notepads and think I should do something with them.
Yeah.
But I think he would be very happy. Mm. You know, Adam is a man who wouldn't mind standing naked in front of a crowd of people if it would get a laugh.
Yeah.
And I'm told there are laughs in the book. I didn't know that when I wrote it.
Oh, no, it's a very funny book. Do you think that also that the book is in some sense exactly what Adam anticipated?
No. There were moments further and further as we got into the process of these interviews, moments where it became clear that Adam had lost control of a very controlling project.
Right.
You know, he was entirely in charge and drew up the circumstances of our first encounters. When he would, you know, in the early sort of tests, I suppose, for want of a better term, that form the front of the book, where he shoots me or throws me off a motorcycle, these are moments of absolute command on his behalf. Mm. And I am sort of shielded by a carapace of naivety and not much else. Mm. And sort of 2 or 3 years in, and certainly 4 years in, you could sense in some interviews a concern in Adam that he was being too honest and that he had said too much.
Yeah.
But there was also a sense that that is what he wanted to do, that's why we're having these conversations in the first instance.
Yeah.
Can I throw a question in on the back of that about the kind of process, the ethnography, if you like? You just used the word interview. I find it so fascinating that you were in kind of interview mode, you know, before or after the vodka, before or after the bike ride. Like, how did that, did you really step into that zone? Were you kind of hanging out and then you'd say, okay, Adam, now we're going to position you in art history kind of thing?
Everything was decidedly on the record in these encounters, even though I was drinking a lot and doing lots of stupid things in the course of the book. I always had a notepad. And, you know, even if we were out on a hunting trip, I would still be carrying a notepad.
He really is a journalist, isn't he?
Taking conscious notes. And partly, there's this strange protection you feel from a Spyrex notepad. And so it was important to carry one around.
That's great. Thank you. Do you want to ask a question?
Yes, I would love to ask a question, Martin. The question I'm interested in is the fulcrum in this book, to my mind, comes very late, and it's the court case that imprisons Namatjira.
Yeah.
And it is a moment of irreparable decline. You know, everything that happens after that can't be changed. Fate has grabbed hold of him. Yes. The world has grabbed hold of him. Mm. And it's ruined him. Mm. And I wonder, Adam was ruined by a court case. I think the embarrassment, but really the reality of standing in court and having to confess that he wasn't so remarkable. He was a drunk man with a car full of guns, and that was it.
Yeah.
And he died soon afterwards because that reality was so painful to confront. But what was it about standing up in court that destroyed Namatjira?
Well, I think there's several things that happened there. Rex Battarbee stepped back in 1956.
Yeah.
So he doesn't have his protector, his dealer, anymore. Then he has his name taken off the register, which is the origin of this quite mistaken view that Albert Namatjira was the first Aboriginal to be granted citizenship in Australia. It's simply not the case. All it was that he had his name taken off the register, which was an apartheid-like instrument used by the Northern Territory government. But and that allowed him to drink alcohol, and it also allowed him to sign away his copyright. So that's the prelude to the court case. The court case, to my mind, was a extremely cynical attempt by certain powerful interests in the Northern Territory to get this man. He was an uppity black, and we've got to get him. So there's an element to it of a conspiracy. But to get to the point of your question, I think what happened when Albert stood up in front of the court was that he realized that everything that he'd posited his life upon, which was his ability as an artist, meant absolutely nothing in the face of an implacable law that was not his law, which he had certainly broken in the letter, but probably not in the spirit. So I think it's very like what happened to Adam in a way, slightly different circumstances, but I think faced with the court case, Albert could no longer believe in himself as the artist that he was. So, I mean, I've been in court, you've probably been in court. Court cases, when you're the defendant, are incredibly sobering experiences, you know?
The great stick that the law has is embarrassment.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shame job, as you call it in the centre.
What's that?
A shame job.
Shame job, yeah.
I'm fascinated to hear what you both feel at the end of the process. What did you learn that you kind of didn't expect to? It's a very teacher question, isn't it? But I'm kind of curious, because often, as you say, you know, you said the question, you started, Martin, by saying that you didn't answer the question, but what did you find out? Maybe it's the tragedy that you've both just described, the impact of the latter on Australian art history in many ways, the remaining ambivalence with which Namatjira is treated. I was so kind of ashamed to be, in some ways, in the industry. The Art Gallery of South Australia, where I work as a curator, was the first to acquire in 1939 in Namatjira, but of course subsequent directors are on record in the Advertiser as saying, we've got enough, thanks. There is no more. So I learned so much. I'm really interested to know, and even about Cullen. I'd made up my mind a bit about Cullen. He did seem like the naughty schoolboy, but I did learn so much about Cullen. What did you learn about your subjects, about yourselves, and about the art of writing?
Someone said to me the other night, when you research and write a book, it becomes part of your DNA. And I thought, that's interesting. I hadn't kind of thought of it like that. But I think writing any kind of, especially non-fiction book, is about codifying and perhaps increasing available knowledge and making it accessible to, you know, those who are interested. So in a sense, I did learn an enormous amount through the process of researching and writing the book, but I also feel very strongly that in the end it's not really about me, it's about the writer as a conduit for certain, in this case, biographical subject matter, certain experiences. So the point about it is to be an agent of transmission.
Mm. Mm.
And hopefully the story sort of enters the world and becomes one along with, you know, all the other stories we tell ourselves.
That act of kind of gathering seems so exhausting. It's so full of erudition, the book. So we begin with almost like a literature review of early Australian anthropological views, well, early 20th century, on Central Australian Aboriginal people, on Aranda, Bluritja, Pitjantjatjara. We get a kind of synopsis of that, very unorthodox and quite kind of controversial, in that Martin decides not to use traditional footnotes. It means that you get this cadence. It's really easy to read because you're reading through these excerpts. And then we travel all the way through, as you mentioned before, kind of to Papunya. Mm. So it is an exceptional kind of, there's an exceptional breadth. There's such a kind of landscape that you cover. I guess in contrast with Eric, and I'd love to hear what you think about the journey, but yours is absolutely a kind of an experience of depth in terms of the human psyche.
Mm. I think, you know, what one thing you said earlier about having made up your mind about Adam before you read the book, mm. as, you know, by the time I met Adam, most of the world had made up their mind about him.
Mm.
He'd run out two lifetimes worth of friendships. He'd chased away anyone who'd got close to him.
Mm.
But he also had very deliberately chosen someone at 19 to write his biography. And one thing about Adam's work is it existed on this precipice of kind of mischief and childlike innocence, and then the malevolence of adulthood. He says at one point in the book that he was 14 when he stopped loving his mother, and that's very much the time at which he stopped growing up as well. And certainly when I started writing this book, I think I probably also was somewhat on that precipice of childlike naivety and an understanding of the adult world, and I think I grew up somewhat and began to understand the adult parts of Adam that he didn't understand. But in terms of what I, you know, learnt while writing the book, it was that, you know, in this very unique circumstance, I was able to understand the two parts of Adam's character because I briefly lived on each while he was alive.
Mm. Excellent, thank you. There's in the collection I worked with formerly at Newcastle, we have an extraordinary constellation of works called the Indaria Suite that have come from Hermannsburg, and we also have, I think, one of the best. It's not reproduced in here, but it is one of the best Cullens, I believe. It's called and has written across it in Cullen's hand, "Nothing's ever yours to keep." And it always kind of reminds me of the flip side, which is the proper now artist from Queensland, Richard Bell, who made a painting that said, "Not yours to lose." And it draws me to what has probably been overlooked, because his behaviour has been the lure for most discussions around Cullen, but that is what I see as a kind of post-colonial, maybe even a decolonial turn, so that the work in the Newcastle collection has this tragic-looking kangaroo, which comes up time and time again in his work, and one of the female figures, which, you know, it's kind of hard to look at, and this text, and there are some boomerangs that are placed over each other that read like the kind of souvenirs that have largely marginalised many Aboriginal artists. So I'm kind of interested in what these two books share, because I think similarly the way you paint the picture of Namatjira and Battarbee allows us to rethink what we've thought of as what really has been received as an understood history and an understood story. Mm. And I think both of you managed to you invite the reader to rethink who we are through the vision of those two artists.
Yeah, hopefully. We were talking about this a little bit before. Eric was saying how many artists become sort of subjectively deluded, prey to fantasy. And it is a curious thing to do, to spend your days and nights constructing an alternative world, because that's basically what artists are doing. in terms of even, you know, representational realist watercolour landscape painting, you are still making an alternate creation to the one that exists. Mm. And I think it's very easy to become maybe not deluded, but perhaps confused between the real world and the world you're constructing. Mm. And I think that's where the job of a biographer perhaps comes in, because hopefully you can retell the story in such a way as to both acknowledge that facility to create alternate worlds, but also say something about the costs that might pertain to doing something like that.
Mm. And I think in Adam's case, he played a very well-worn archetype of the wild man painter, you know, living on the fringe of society and dispatching these canvases back to us so we might understand what happens there.
Yeah.
He played that character in the press, but also in his work. I mean, one of the things that drew me to him as a subject was just how large a figure he was in the press, how terrific he was at manipulating the press's understanding of who he was. And I, you know, the character he had was so structurally unsound, I was keen to disassemble it, because I think finding the small and very troubled man behind that great curtain tells us a lot about what we demand from our artists, but the ludicrousness of expecting that any person could be anything like this. And with Adam, you know, much of it was real. You know, a lot of it existed in his mind, but when he turned around with a shotgun, the shotgun was real. You know, when he was at his weapons trial, it was real. When he was stupidly drunk, painting occasionally sublime pictures, it was real. It's just that there is no deeper nourishment to that personality because he'd imagined only the front of it and hadn't properly created any of the back of it. And I don't think art had encouraged him to create the back of it. And I think, you know, in both these stories, we learn a lot about the viciousness and the unpleasantness that the art world can be as a place sometimes, in terms of what is demanded of Namatjira from various figures in the art world and what was demanded of Cullen.
And a lot of it in the art world comes down to the fact that there are quite often very large amounts of money involved for things that are intrinsically aren't monetizing objects, really.
As Adam says in the book at one point, they take this shit out of my house and call it art. It's so great.
So Eric illustrates the development, if you like, of Cullen's practice. We get the early work. One of my favourites is My Parents' Phone Number Is, and he aerosols his parents' phone number across the surface. All the way through to the final illustration in Eric's book is the portrait of you.
Yeah.
And I wanted, as a point of contrast, we mentioned earlier that we don't see illustrations of Namatjira or Battarbee. Battarbee could have been illustrated, but that would have perhaps performed a slight on Namatjira.
Well, it would have looked odd to only have had Rex's paintings in the book and none of Albert's. Yeah.
It always strikes me as a great irony that the artists that we knew, really, if you're my age or older, we knew via the reproductions of Legend Press, we no longer see via reproduction. Fortunately, we do see Namatjira much more in art galleries today. And, of course, all of his lineage, all of his children and grandchildren and all of those Arundamob who are still making work, sometimes in clay, sometimes in punu, sometimes in watercolour. But it seems to be so interesting that, and in some ways fortunate. The other thing is that I've always been struck by the irony that 1936, the camping trip, was also the year that Walter Benjamin wrote a work of art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction.
Those
two
connection.
Dates kind of stick in my head, those two realities stick in my head because, of course, what Benjamin was saying was that a work through reproduction will lose its aura. It will lose its auratic sacred power. And that would be something that I think Namatjira would have been really interested in discussing.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. And it's true, most people know Namatjira's work from the Legend Press and reproductions. The reason why there are no paintings in this book is because of Legend Press. Now, they bought 87.5% of Namatjira's copyright in 1957. They left him with 12.5%. And that was expressed as a royalty while he was alive. After he died intestate, that 12.5% that remained with him was administered by the Northern Territory government and then subsequently sold to Legend Press. So for $8,600, I think it was. So none of the money that comes from any licensing with Namatjira's work goes back to the family.
That's right.
It goes to Legend Press. Now, we began to negotiate with them at a fairly early stage, and they were perfectly amenable, seemingly, until it came to the point of actually discussing specifics. And at that point, we were informed that, yes, we could reproduce any of Namatjira's works we wanted to, only nothing from the Araluen Centre in Alice Springs and nothing from the National Gallery in Canberra, which are the two biggest collections of Namatjira works in the country.
And where your readers would then go to see the work, of course.
Yes, and that was because Legend Press were in dispute with them, which will be a financial matter.
We're going to throw to questions in a minute, but I have one last question, and I want to know what is next for these two writers. Do you want to go first, Eric?
Yeah, I'm just finishing up the first draft of a screenplay of the book for Rob Connolly, so that will be out in a couple of years.
Fantastic. So Rob Connolly, probably Paper Planes is his most recent hit. That is very exciting.
This will be a feel-good family film just like that.
Brilliant. Brilliant.
There's a camel hunt in that film, isn't there?
Great. Thank you. And Martin?
Oh, I've been working on a biography of the convict artist Joseph Lycett. And it's at a sort of a first draft stage at the moment. It's
a rather elusive figure who has
Well, it's a perverse thing to do. Yeah. I often say I've chosen to write a biography of someone about whom nothing is known. So
yes.
it has its difficulties. Its working title is Mortal Things.
Yes. So. Great. Brilliant. Wish you both all the best with those.
Thank you.
So we've got about 7 minutes, I think, for questions. Please, given the brevity, if you'd like to come, there's a microphone in the centre down here somewhere, so you have to. Sorry. That's the gig. That's the deal. So just come on down, and we'll be very, very friendly. Come on.
Just a question for Eric. What was your major study?
I didn't go to university, so I can scarcely read.
Life.
Just reading. So you didn't did you do journalism?
No. I just went from school to journalism.
I didn't know that before I used Wunderkind, but I'm kind of right, aren't I?
Ill-educated Wunderkind. You choose.
Yeah. So you studied journalism?
No, I didn't do any study. Sorry.
Impressive.
Great. Thank you. Next question.
I'm interested in why you were selected by Adam Cullen at 19 to
take
on his biography.
I think, if I were to be honest with myself, I seemed like one of the few people who would bother hanging around with him at that time. quite really. I was an earnest journalist at that point, willing to ask a man who was incredibly vain questions about himself. It seemed like a kind of perfect situation. But at the same time, he was an enormous intellect, and we did have very engaged and testing conversations early on, and I think that is probably also one of the reasons he enjoyed my company for a time.
Are you saying he recognised your intellect, did he?
Well, and the spare time I had.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you both very much. I have a question from Eric. You mentioned a little bit earlier about disassembling Adam Cullen. In the process, were you also disassembled?
Good question.
No, I mean, I hope that I'm not very much in this book, although I inevitably stray into it. I saw my job as moving a mirror around him, hoping to try and catch different bits, and invariably I think I caught myself in that mirror now and then, because there are moments where if I'm not in the book, it's very hard to know what's happening. But I wrote the book without thinking about myself really very much at all, and yet thinking a lot about who Adam was, and certainly in the time that we were doing these interviews, Adam never asked me a question about myself, and I asked him many about him.
Mm. Mm. Eric is going to be played by someone very handsome in the film.
That's in the contract.
Excellent. Any more questions? I hope you've enjoyed this session. Can I ask you to join me in thanking and congratulating these two extraordinary authors?
Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you.